entire interview was conducted with David Moses for the Purdue University Library's Oral History Program. It took place on Friday, June 29th, 2007, at his residence in West Lafayette. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Oral History Librarian. Welcome. Tell us where you were born in your early years in school, siblings.
Well, I was born in Kendallville, Indiana, which is up north of Fort Wayne. And I have one brother, and my parents were there. I had lots of cousins and grandparents, and a rather nice childhood growing up there. And when I graduated from high school at Kendallville, that very summer I came down and entered Purdue as a student, and spent 4 years at Purdue as a student, graduated on Sunday, and went to work for Purdue on Monday. So then was here clear through until retirement.
Okay, let's back up a little bit. In high school, first of all, tell us when you were born, your birth date, and tell us a little bit about
June 4, 1932.
And what was high school? Was there any clubs or any activities that you participated in? Was it a large school?
Well, we had graduating class of, I think, 69 in there, so it's not too big a school, but probably the biggest school in the county.
What prompted your decision to, how'd you happen to come to Purdue?
My dad had gone to Purdue back in the late teens, and so it was the natural to come to Purdue from that.
What was your major, and did you live on campus? Tell us a little about campus life when you were.
Well, yeah, I moved into Perry Hall as a freshman, and during my sophomore year, Hall X opened, and I lived then 3 years in Hall X, and back to high school, if you want to get that in first, I did a lot of stage things, particularly lighting and scenery on the stage, a little bit of acting, but not too much, and a few track events in sports. That's not a lot of that either, so. And worked at the local dime stores where you make money to pay for roller skates and go to the skating rink, things of that sort. But coming down to Purdue, I was also a Boy Scout while I was a teenager and spent time at the Boy Scout camp on the waterfront. So while I was here at Purdue, the first summer I was here, I was also a part-time lifeguard over in the field house, and quickly gave up that kind of activity and got more interested in photography things, which I had been doing also in high school. And
tell us a little about what was campus like and living on campus in those days.
The main residence hall for men was Carey Hall, and it was pretty full, and then they built Hall X, which was originally built west of the women's residence hall as a women's residence, but they needed men's residence hall, so men went in it first, and other than the long walk from that, you know, from the far end of the campus out into the buildings was fine.
Do you participate in? What about athletics or anything of that sort?
I didn't really participate in athletic things. I was in camera clubs and on the exponent staff as a photographer.
So your interest is in photography?
Interest is in photography and things of that sort. Residence hall politics. President of Excalibur Club.
What is, for the researchers, what is X Hall known as today, the residence hall? Is that, what is the hall known as today? Is that Meredith? I'm not sure.
I'd have to get the map, but yeah, I think that's Meredith.
Okay. Okay, now, did you, your family, did you meet your wife while you were here?
No, our grandparents were friends back in Kendallville, and our parents were good friends, and so she was one of the girls from home, and we got together, and she had gone, She went to Indiana University, so we had to get that resolved. I also was in ROTC while I was at Purdue. So I spent, and if you do that, 4 years of ROTC, that takes a lot of your time, too. So I'm not sure.
When did you, what was your graduating class?
Well,
when you graduated?
I graduated in 1955, and with my degree in industrial, trade in industrial education, to go out and be a shop teacher. My interest was in, I said, photography, and I was in the Signal Corps, ROTC, and that was right at the end of the Korean conflict. They weren't particularly looking for career officers at that moment. So when I graduated, well, while I was still a senior, I got a call from Denver Sams, from the, who was one of my shop teachers here on campus, that they were looking for someone to work in the film library. Thought that might be a good chance to stay on campus and work on a master's degree. So I went over, applied, and got the job, which is how I graduated on Sunday and went to work for Purdue on Monday in the film library, part of the libraries. And the film library at the time was housed in the basement of Michael Golden Shops, which was originally intended to be a storage unit, I think. We're talking about a pretty dismal looking place, down a ramp at the north end of the building.
What was in the film library?
The film library had stacks with films in it, 16 millimeter motion pictures primarily, a few slide sets and some microfilm and things of that sort.
Okay.
And some of the equipment. And in fact, they ran an equipment service out of there and had one room that was set up so that you could bring a class of maybe 20 in to see a film. But they also took projectors out from there and sent people out to run projectors in other places like the electrical engineering big lecture hall in Double E, where they had a big art projector to run that most instructors couldn't run.
So you started your career. Now that brings us to
I got into that primarily through an interest in photography.
And that brings us to the Audiovisual Center, and I'd like to kind of expand a little bit on that. That really started, according to some research, around 1950 in November, by the director of libraries for procurement and storage and distribution.
Right. There were several parts to the Audiovisual Center.
Good.
The film library was one part. A motion picture production unit was another part. And another was the television research unit, which was set apart separately from the TV people to essentially study to see if the use of TV did any good. So that's, keep it independent to keep the research independent of the people who were actually doing it. But that came under the director of libraries. Warren Seibert, probably the name most remembered there.
They also said there was an AV in 66, there was an AV graphics unit and the agricultural visual aids.
Now that came essentially from the ag department into the AV center, and although there was a piece of that in the audiovisual center, the ag school kept a pretty good control over some of that too.
Mm-hmm.
That didn't happen until 1958, and they moved into Stewart Center, where there was room to do it.
Well, then bringing together, there was a film library, and then they brought together into Stewart Center?
When Stewart Center opened, my career with it was, I started in 55, and then in early 56, I took a leave of absence for 6 months to go on active duty military training and got back in October of 56, and then worked in the film library from 56 then into 57, and then took another leave of absence for a year and worked in the chemistry department on a Fund for the Advancement of Education project on the study of using chemistry for teaching, study of television in teaching chemistry. Get that straight. And worked primarily with George Honig, probably retired by now. but that was an interesting year's project. And then back to the film library, just as they were getting ready to move into Stewart Center. I kept involved enough that I was able to get into Stewart Center while the building was going on to look at different rooms and see how things were going and to, you know, to have an idea of how the building was coming along. But probably more importantly to the development of that was L.D. Miller, who was the film librarian and held forth in the basement of Michael Golden's shops. And one of L.D.'s ideas was that this media, the motion pictures particularly, that were considered mass media would be just as valuable or more valuable for individual students to use if they needed that information. And so we had already set up in the basement of Michael Golden's shops a little corner where you could set up a projector and an individual student or two or three could sit and look at a film that when they would come in. And they could just take it off the shelf and look at it. Well, the new facilities in Stewart Center were set up with several small viewing and listening rooms where that could be set up. And this was really pretty innovative in the film library world. We had a lot of room to rattle in when we first moved in, but we eventually consumed it all and ran out of space. But probably one of the important things was the individual use of mass media. And all of the material, it was set up very much like a library's reserved book room, where all the materials were held essentially, you know, behind the counter. You came up, used the card catalog, found what you wanted, made a request over the counter, and it was handed to you over the counter with an offer to show you how to run the projector if you didn't know. And we probably taught a lot of people how to run audiovisual equipment because they wanted to do it for themselves. And so we had usually two rooms for pretty much all the time and several other rooms that were set up with various pieces of equipment, tape recorders, slide projectors, film strip projectors, and we'd check these items over the counter and they would take them in and view them and bring them back. And that was very successful, and we ran that at pretty much library hours, you know, from about 8 in the morning till 10 at night, and on weekends.
Where did the collection, where did the films come from? Did you purchase these?
The collection
to support
was purchased.
The academic departments?
They were purchased to support the academic department, and a lot of it got started supporting the agriculture program, because we were essentially part of the outreach service of the university. We mail ordered films all over the state, particularly to the 92 counties and the county agents. And we had a lot of agricultural films as a part of that, but we also had engineering and social science materials.
How did it move in and get, had it always in the early days been part of the libraries, so it became the libraries and audiovisual center under the director of the libraries? administratively?
At Purdue it was, yes. I think other places, it was probably separately, but it primarily it went into the libraries here at Purdue, which is probably where it belonged in the first place everywhere.
Sure. And then you loaned out, you had equipment, and you did the cataloging down there, too?
We did cataloging of materials and of the non-print materials and the shelving of them and
maintenance,
because those things are high maintenance.
Sure.
And then we also had a shipping department to ship them out, received them back in, inspected them, got them back on the shelf, ready to go.
I bet you were glad to move to larger quarters than the...
Oh, yeah. That was great.
Yeah. One of the things I read, Dave, is in March of 63, the first Dean's Conference on the Improvement of Instruction on the Purdue campus, and you were the system librarian, there was a picture. So it must have... Yeah. You don't recall that one, but that just a picture and a few captions, and you happen to be in it, so I thought it was it sort of grabbed me on the improvement of instruction on the Purdue campus, and you were showing some films and things, or equipment, probably.
Well, we
probably did quite
always promoted the use of the audiovisual materials throughout the campus, and we were very quick and willing to go out and take the materials out to people or show them how to run the equipment, to teach people how to run equipment. The motion picture projector was fairly intimidating to a lot of people. We tried to overcome that, as many people as we could. We had a room set up with all kinds of equipment and ran training sessions for whole classes down there, particularly the education majors. We were going to go out into public schools and teach and do the same thing.
And we'd be using media and films and things of that sort.
And one of the areas that had been a media user for quite a while was the modern language department, where they had used tape recordings. Well, we very quickly got into providing tape recordings at hours that they weren't open, where they would put modern language tapes into the film library, where the students could come and use those whenever they wanted to work on their language skills. And then this started to spread into other subjects as well. And I can't begin to give you the days, but one of them, we can't leave Sam Postlewaite out. Sam Postlewaite from Botany and Plant Pathology was walking through the film library one day lamenting the fact that his students were not getting what he thought they ought to out of some of the lectures. And I knew that he recorded those lectures, and so I said, well, why don't you bring those tapes over here and put them in the library, and then tell your students that if they need additional information, to come over and listen to them. Or if they miss the lecture, tell them to come over and listen to it. So he put a tape in the library, and the students came over and listened to it. And a week or so later, he came back in, and he brought a tape, and he put a twig in the box so they could look at leaf nodes and things of that sort. The next time, he had a quarter section of a log with him to put in the box so that he'd count annual rings and find the cadmium layer between the bark and the hardwood. And, you know, it just grew from that until he had an entire course on tape and with things to go with it, boxed up, so to speak, and ran one or two sections of his class. They didn't go to labs over in Life Science Building. They went to their labs down in our film library, where they could do it at any time of the day or night during the week they chose to. And it worked. And from there, a thing called the audio tutorial system was born and became internationally known.
Right. The use of the AV, was it used, a lot of people in the state would also use your collection, use the collection here for the films and things, was there much?
We ship films all over the state and even out of the state, but primarily in the state, because almost every state had a library within the state that took care of educational needs within their own state.
Sure.
Indiana University had a much larger library, film library, than Purdue did, but we had certain kinds of things that they didn't have.
Right.
So, particularly the agricultural and engineering things.
Being a land-grant institution.
Right.
How did you get, when you became director, when did that occur, and how did that come about?
Through death, I guess.
You were the film librarian, been a film librarian
well,
for a while.
No, I was the assistant film librarian for quite a while, well, for about 13 years. And then one Saturday morning, L.D. Miller dropped in, just about like that quick. Where, you know, no problem, Friday afternoon when we left work. And
Saturday, was he the film librarian?
He was the film librarian.
Okay.
And Saturday morning, he was gone. And I was told to go in Monday morning and take charge. So that was sort of the way it was. I think officially it took another year to have it happen officially, but that's really what happened.
But then they changed the unit. It was still the audiovisual, but then you came in charge of that.
It was still the film library.
Okay.
And but things were changing. And I probably can't even be accurate about the progression of changes, but there was not only the film library, but this motion picture production unit and the TV research unit and all that sort of thing. And Miller had sort of been I can't give you exactly who actually had what titles, but I sort of found myself rather having all these people reporting to me from the different units, but it was pretty pretty loose because they were all pretty autonomous groups anyway, and I spent my time primarily with the film library and its activities, which also, we had the biggest staff. We had 20 some people, as compared with the research unit, probably had 4, maybe 5, and the motion picture unit maybe had half a dozen, 6 or 8.
Then it came to doing some of this research. Then they had a reorganization. Was that in 81, approximately, or 80s or something, when the AV Center, when you became, when moved into undergrad library services and director of that?
Well, I had moved upstairs and was essentially, it's kind of unknown as to who was reporting to whom at where at what during a period of time there, I think. And when Oliver Dunn left, I moved upstairs and into Oliver's office, which was a pretty nice place to go. And then John Wilshusen took over as film librarian. But it was not until the early 80s that we got into the undergraduate library building. And Joe Donese came in and wanted to know if I wanted to honcho getting the undergraduate library built. And that, being an industrial ed major who could read the blueprints, didn't have to ask more than once. Because that's, more down my alley.
And you, I consider you the building construction photographer because you took a lot of pictures. That was wonderful.
More pictures than you ever knew what to do with.
But they served a very useful purpose.
Well, it's always nice to have a few extras.
Right, especially with the anniversary and
it's pictures. Easier to throw them away than it is to wish you had.
Yeah. Backing up a little bit on the audiovisual center, how did the staffing, did that whole center increase over time as far as staffing? You did mention that earlier, but you had faculty
well,
down there too.
When we lived over in Michael Golden Shops, the film library, and L.D. Miller was the film librarian, there was probably a clerk and a half that ran the counter and typed up the orders. A couple of students. I came in as the assistant film librarian and did many of the shipping, a lot of the shipping and writing catalogs and things. And there was also a maintenance man, Orestes Hood. I don't know if you ever knew him or not. Marvelous gentleman. But he was back in the back room, taking care of all the equipment from all around campus. But that was the whole group. And then when we moved over to the other building, you couldn't run that kind of a staff. So there, well, to begin with, the year, the 57, 58 year, Ron Baker came in as another assistant film librarian. That was the year that I was in the chemistry department. So there was L.D. Miller and Ron Baker and I were the three probably administrators in the film library. Then we had an office clerk, and we had some scheduling clerks in the scheduling office, and we had picked up another, person in the shop, and probably another one in the shop, probably a couple in the shop by then, and a shipping clerk. So we just had to keep picking up people, if nothing else, simply because we had what went from this little hole in the wall, hardly hole in the wall, hole in the ground over there, to a place that had about 40 rooms in it. And although some of those were very small rooms to use occasionally, we had to staff quite a few places. About five places that really had to be staffed, and you couldn't staff them with one person even. So it's
and we had all that equipment too.
And all the equipment that had to be taken care of. That kept growing. The library itself, number of materials kept growing, and the amount of service that we provided out across the campus kept growing. We expanded the projection service so that we had quite a cadre of students that went out, and eventually we even got to the point where we hired two firemen from the Lafayette Fire Department. We hired an A shift man and a B shift man because they worked every other day, and we could get them, between the two of them, each one 3 days a week. We had 6 day coverage to have somebody who could really know the equipment and be able to provide projection service any place on campus whenever it was needed. And they were, you know, just so much more reliable than trying to find students between classes. And so, you know, we got to be a much more professional service.
Do you remember the film unit or the research unit moved into the library?
Well, they were up on the third floor.
Even when it was when Warren was doing more of the looking at television.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, as a research project.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, I remember there. I thought maybe they might have been, the location might have been with the film or the AV center.
Well, no, that whole unit just sort of morphed into the technical service, the computer.
Right, exactly.
Things for the library.
Right. Do you remember MAPATI, the Midwest program?
MAPATI?
Yes.
Sure.
I like to make comments on that. A lot of people don't recall it. I remember reading about it. I know it existed, but share a couple comments on it. Wasn't it unique? Purdue was very unique in that.
The Midwest program for airborne television was a government grant to study the use of broadcast television, broadcast over a large area from an airplane. And Empatty had a had a DC-6AB airplane that was equipped with a very long antenna that they dropped down from underneath the plane when they got up in the air, and then they went up and flew a little tight circle over northeastern Indiana and covered a very wide range with broadcast television. And they loaded that plane. It had, that was back in the days of 2-inch wide videotapes. So huge reels of tape. And those tapes were produced at different places, but were primarily duplicated and prepared to go up in the basement of Stewart Center, and then taken out to the airport, put on the plane, and taken up and broadcast from up in the air. It was just, you know, was something they did 4 or 5 days a week during public schools were going.
Very unique in that time.
As I know, it was the only time that was ever done.
That's right. And did Ohio, Michigan, Illinois, Indiana, I think.
Flying up there over the something, Montpelier strikes me.
Correct.
As being one of the sort of the center of where they were flying.
That's where they did the zigzag. It was a figure of eight is what they would do.
They flew up there, and from that point they could cover a very large area.
Yeah.
And broadcast educational television.
Very good.
And, you know, it was before cable. And, of course, now with cable, it's sort of unnecessary to do things like that.
Let's talk a little bit about the Alumni Association. Have been involved in the Alumni Association?
Well, only a little.
Okay.
Some.
You were involved in one of their class reunions.
I've been involved in several class reunions.
Any Purdue tradition that particularly kind of sticks in your mind when you were a student or later, such as the Boilermaker, anything special when you think of Purdue traditions? Any come to your mind?
Well, I think one of the things that we don't have now that we did have then is that prior to football games, we used to have a lot of decorations put up at fraternities, sororities, housing units, you know, touting Purdue and mean-mouthing the opposition, big displays, and those were always kind of fun. People, competed to see who could put up the best display and things of that sort.
I remember those. Particularly, I remember them at homecoming. They always had they had something special.
Yes. Well, I think that's the big one was homecoming.
Yeah, probably. Right? Yeah. Now, talk. What have you been doing since your retirement? And tell us about the dulcimer.
Mostly since retirement, I've tried to do nothing. People would ask me, "What do you want to do when you retire?" And my only response was, "Do." I don't want to do and I retire. And that's really sort of what I've done. I haven't really been too involved. I came back and did a couple of projects with the library, but that's
right.
All.
Yeah.
And
are you still involved with the Historical Society?
Several years ago, when my tenure on the board of TCHA ran out, I retired from that too. So
it's sort of a people don't realize a lot of things that are stored there.
Oh, there's a lot of stuff there.
Right. And you hear
The Winters collection certainly is one of the.
Now, the libraries, Winters has been doing some work with that. Yeah. They got a grant on that. Sammy's been working with that. And they've got the Feast of the Hundred Moon, and the anniversary, I think, this year is going to be, it's like the 35th or something like that, up in the 30s.
It's getting up there.
Yeah. In the early years, so you were more involved, you used to do the corn?
Well, we did parched corn for about, over a period of about 16 years.
Yeah.
And introduced a lot of people to parched corn.
Including people in the library who never experienced it, right.
Well, parched corn is something you read about or you hear about, but you never get a chance to stick it in your mouth.
Tell us about your family. Where are the children? How many children do you have? And do you have any grandchildren?
We have four. Carol and I have four kids, and they are all Purdue graduates. And we have one that went a little astray and has a master's degree from IU, but we try not to hold that against her. But,
that's because her mother went to IU, right?
No, it's because she wanted a degree that she could get down there. And
where do the children live?
Starting with the oldest, Ann is in Toledo with her husband, Greg Castraba, who used to be in WBAA here. And Ann and Greg have two little girls up there. Susan and Paul live here in town. They live in Lafayette over the other side of Columbian Park. They have our oldest granddaughter, who's 13, and a son, and also a son who's 10. And we still play music with them because they play good Irish music, whistles and mandolin and banjo and things like that. And Brenda and her husband Scott live in West Lafayette, and Scott teaches TV at Purdue, and Brenda's got two little boys that she tries to keep up with at home, pretty active, and our youngest Scott and his wife Jessica live in West Orange, New Jersey. And they've lived out there for quite a while, and they now have four little girls in their house.
So we've got quite a few grandchildren.
They're a good dad, don't you say? But they just had a new baby last October.
Oh, that's nice. Yeah. We get together every year. They come. Children all get together.
Everybody's going to be here. Kids will be here from New Jersey the 4th of July, and they're coming from Toledo, and mostly, the reason for coming is because next a week from tomorrow is our 50th wedding anniversary. And I'm saying congratulations to us for making it.
That's very nice. What sort of activity? Do you have any special? You have a dinner or something special?
We're going over to Brenda's with the whole crowd, but beyond that, I don't really know. It's a little scary to think about.
That's very nice. Congratulations. That's nice. So in your retirement, you can keep pretty busy, right? With the dulcimers and things of that sort.
Sure.
With your call.
And
the chairs.
Redoing chairs.
Right. Exactly. How about an outstanding event in your life, when I ask you that?
Oh, I got married. Hey, what more could
And you got a favorite memory of Purdue or in that you like to share with us?
I think it's not a favorite memory. It's many, and it's mostly the people that I've had the opportunity to meet over the years. Lillian Gilbert, for one, and her daughter. Can't miss her. And people like that, people who come through, and so, people whose names I don't even know now, but you had a chance to see, hear, and hear speak. I even met Arthur Fiedler here one night. That was when I was a student, as a matter of fact. In fact, being a photographer for the exponent, got you into a lot of places. Like, I think I may have only set one game, football game, in the stands. I think I spent the rest of them all out on the field with my camera, which is a lot more fun than sitting in the stands. Of course, if you get hit by a football player, or run into, which only happened once, but that's once is enough. But that, you know, there are things like being in, with the camera, being able to go places and do things, getting into things that otherwise might not.
You got digital? Are you using digital camera now?
Now I don't know what to do with the old film cameras. Even using the film library, at one time I had a little talk that I gave called Motion Pictures as Art. And I don't know how many places I gave that as a talk. And
do you remember any particular points of it that you'd like to share?
It's just that films can affect you in the same way as doing art. There was one film that my guess is that it's probably long gone from, well, the whole film library is long gone now, but there was a film called A Movie, a little 10-minute black and white film, which was really pretty awful thing to look at, but in the beginning of the film, everything was kind of fun and jolly. And by the time you got to the end of that film, the same pictures were death. And you could take a group of people from very lively and to down where they're ready to talk about serious things in 10 minutes. First time I saw the film used was for a church conference here at Purdue. Don't remember what denomination, but it's kind of one that you wonder about them using this film, because it starts out with a stripper on a bed. But because they knew what this film could do, they used it. Because they knew at the end of 10 minutes, they'd have that crowd in a very serious mood. And you can demonstrate that with films. And that's what that Films as Art was. That had to be followed by a rather upbeat film to get people back into the swing of things.
Right.
But that was a fun little package that you could take out and entertain people with for the better part of an hour, I suppose.
Right.
And had a lot of fun with.
Yeah. You served on Dr. Moriarty, Mr. Moriarty, and also Joe Dagnese, and then Emily, right? So you had three directors.
Mm-hmm.
And then the presidents would have been Hubby, Art Hansen, and Bering.
Right.
Right. Changes will take place along the way with that.
Well, they're very different kinds of people. And I always like to think that, you know, at one point in time, I think I was, I was about third from the president, but then things change even within the libraries, and suddenly you find out you're about 15th. But, just in the way the structure of the university goes, and it really doesn't make any difference, because even third, you never make contact. But I had another advantage, though, and that is my father-in-law. L.D. Baker was my father-in-law, and he was a state legislator and on the budget committee. So if he came to campus, he met with the president and the vice president and all of those, and often if he was invited to one of their social gatherings, he would take Carolyn and I along, which gave us a chance to meet a number of people. And interact with those people.
Yeah.
So that was, that was a very nice thing, as long as I, keep quiet like I'm supposed to, and seen and not heard, I'm okay.
Yeah.
But it was, you know, that certainly, you know, I have to look at that as an advantage.
Right.
Certainly.
Anything that you thought I should ask that I didn't, and I forget anything you'd like to say in summary or anything further? Any additional?
Well, I think as I look back at it now, you know, what, this 11 years or so away from being gone, and I read some of the email that comes through, and I read some of the newsletters that come out, and I see a lot of the changes that are going on. One of the reasons that I retired essentially a year early, so to speak, was because the changes that were coming on fast enough that I didn't want to make them in my last year. And I knew that I would not go work beyond age 65, so I preferred to leave before a lot of those things suddenly, I had to do them in that last year. And I knew they were going to happen. And change has to happen. And I just felt that it was better to let somebody else make the changes. So it was easier to get out and let people do it. And I just see the way the libraries are changing. And it's just, well, there's not much you can do about it. It's going to change, with or without us. And if the library doesn't go along with it, then it's too bad.
I have a question.
And it appears that in many cases, the libraries are making a real strong attempt to make the change with the times.
Right. One question I wanted to...